Welcome to the Polyurethane Chemistry Learning Module of BYK's Wetting and Dispersing Series. I'm your host, Michelle Gabriel Caldwell. Let's review the fundamentals of wetting and dispersing additives. The key functions are to wet the pigment particles, to aid in dispersion or the processing, and to improve or enhance stabilization. The effects of this will be to optimize the processing and handling of the coatings, as well as improving any properties. And last but not least, but probably most important, would be long-term storage stability. In other modules, we highlight certain chemistries. Today, we're going to focus on polyurethane additives that were actually developed during a time in the coatings industry when the increased usage of organic pigments required improved wetting and better color development. The industry also saw a move away from lead and chrome-based pigments. Sophisticated resin systems and grinding mechanisms were also evolving, so it's no wonder we look to polyurethanes to meet those needs. Simple fatty acid chemistries were a thing of the past and needed to be upgraded. Structuring polymers for wetting and dispersing additives became an art at BYK. The foundation of pigment affinic groups with resin or solvent compatible end groups turned into design projects with new architecture and polymerization methods. Molecular weights became the marker of great wetting and dispersing additives. Higher molecular weight polymers had more pigment affinic groups and wider ranges of compatibility. So understanding the effects of polarity became a really great indicator for additive selection. We gained a greater appreciation of the bonds of the pigment affinic groups, thereby helping formulators make better additive choices when working in either acidic, basic, or non-ionic systems. Recognizing that most systems respond best to the acid-base theory of interaction, and this garners improved absorption to the pigment surface. Developing not just one, but a family of polyurethane products enhanced steric stabilization mechanisms with polymeric side chains and increasing absorption to organic pigments provided excellent wetting, dispersion, and long-term storage stability. The key indicators and the key factors of wetting and dispersing additives. Not only did we meet those functional needs, but we also offered a wide range of products to meet the needs of the plethora of systems for new organic pigments in this emerging market. Deflocculation additives were providing a function of reducing grind viscosities, obtaining the primary particle size to enhance color effects, and assured flexibility in different end uses. In producing polyurethane additives, we understood the dynamics of molecular weight, the nuances of the chemistry and the chemical backbones of the additives, and the functionality of the pigment affinic groups to provide a diverse range of products. We also see the polyurethane chemistries as the gateway to new additive archetypes for multiple end uses, and that would lead the way to our expanded portfolio. It was also the polyurethane chemistries that would spark the idea of additive selection choices. What's an end use? General industrial, automotive, describing the system, having these conversations also sort of opened up a understanding of the needs in the coatings industry in the market. So whether or not systems were basic or acid catalyzed, we were able to develop products to meet those needs. The next portion was also trying to define how individuals were actually grinding, what the industry's markets and needs were in the area. And then the environmental factors. I mean, obviously, the move away from chrome and lead-based pigments sort of sparked another movement, if you will, in environmental ideas. And then last but not least, really actually seeing a interest in end use specific ideas, right? Whether or not something was a base coat or a top coat or OEM or refinish, all of those things really started to meld in a way that enhanced our ideas of what wetting and dispersing additives could be. The discussion of how much to use became critical with more particularly expensive pigments that were becoming on the market, particularly when compared to titanium dioxide types. The surface areas of inorganic pigments are small, and the need for wetting is relatively low. Organic pigments came with the problem of non-polar surfaces, and these areas were traditionally using other additives, older generation additives, were quite ineffective. The higher the hydrophilicity, the higher the polarity of the particle surface. This picture depicts the surface area of carbon black, and we will use this to define the concept of covering the surface area. There are normally two things that can happen when attempting to properly wet and disperse carbon black pigments. The first is not using enough of the additive for stabilization. Sure, it may give the illusion of viscosity reduction during the grind phase, but we also see problems long-term with storage stability and actual color development. Two, selecting an incompatible additive that now prefers to create micelles. Well, of course, if it's not covering the pigment at all, we're not going to get any benefits. But in addition, we're also going to find other problems in the system like foam generation. The goal is to improve the pigment affinity and the coverage for optimal performance and stabilization. This is why we highly recommend incorporating ladder studies as routine with new formulations, and even when changing a raw material in the system, because this could potentially change the overall compatibility of the additive that was formerly compatible in the system. Taking into consideration any treatments on the pigment surface, noting that those pigments that tout easy to disperse may still benefit from using proper wetting and dispersing additives. Along with ladder studies, grinding time evaluations may prove that the right additive can not only decrease grinding process time, but also can have a very positive effect on delta E values. Whether you choose single grind productions or co-grinds, knowing that the amount that is used is critical, and the guess or the guesstimation should be starting maybe about midway in the recommendation and doing that ladder study. The focus here is that for polyurethanes with basic pigment affinic groups, we can see improved color development with carbon blacks. BYK's portfolio is wide. Additive selection is made easy when the pigment affinic groups with the proper polarity system are all taken into consideration. But remember, we are here to help. Please join our other chemistry modules and learn more about the differences and enhanced features. To check your knowledge, take our quiz. Hope to see you in the next module or accompanying video cast. Bye.